Good afternoon. I'm Barbara Haake, and we are having Mounds View today. And my first guest on Mounds View today is Jim Ericson, our Mounds View City Administrator. That's the formal title. One time was city clerk, at one clerk treasurer, what was it? Tell me how you've evolved into being the city administrator.
Well, Barbara, it's a long and winding road, but fortunately it's always kept me here in Mounds View. The position is city administrator. The title prior to that was city clerk administrator. The charter has the position responsible for those duties, the clerk duties, and there are statutory duties associated with the clerk that are rolled into the title. Most of the city administrators in the metro area are city administrators, even though they retain some of those clerk duties. So when the council made that change and the charter commission went along with it, it was really more of a means to make it more consistent with other administrators in the metro area. But the duties remain the same. No, none of the duties changed.
Yeah, I know that in various things, and I used to be the League of Women Voters, and we looked at city manager versus administrator, et cetera. Give me, and then there's the strong city manager and a weak council or something. Give me some of the other things that you do the same duties.
Sure.
But what are all the differences?
Well, the biggest difference really is whether it's a city manager or a city administrator. If it's a city manager, and Blaine and New Brighton have a city manager form of administration, the council has less of a role in managing the day-to-day operations of the city. With a city manager type of organization, the manager makes the hiring decisions and the terminations. Personnel decisions really fall at the manager's desk as opposed to going to the city council. And that's really the primary difference. Being the administrator, I carry out the policies and the directions of the city council. And there's most of what I do on a day-to-day basis is derived from the direction of the council. And I think that's where it's different with the city manager is the manager is provided with much more control over what happens.
I know, because at one time even the residents in Mounds View started saying, gee whiz, staff has too much to say and the council isn't doing, you know, that, et cetera. But I believe that with what you're describing should be what a lot of the citizens believe in Mounds View, is where the council has more of the direction it gives. And as you said, you follow through with it.
Correct.
But that's just, the hiring is mainly your major difference.
Essentially, yes.
Yeah. Gotcha. Just before we went on air, we just briefly hit a little bit about the Viking Stadium, which looks like it may not happen. I mean, who knows? It's a fast-moving duck in a shooting gallery right now. But sooner or later, it's going to be industrial, and we'll have something developed there.
Something will be developed on the TCAP property,
yes. Yeah. But I know that one thing people were always concerned about was the infrastructure and road reconfiguration. We see a lot going on down at I-94 right now, and how 10 comes in. Can you give me any update as to what's going on or what's happening with anything like that?
Well, MnDOT is moving forward with some reconstruction activity, and in fact, sometime in June, they don't know the precise date, they will be dropping the bridges over 35W that feed County Road 10. Both of the bridges, the southbound bridge that crosses over 35W that feeds into Highway 10, as well as the northbound from 35 to County 10 bridge will be coming down. And I believe that's to make more space for more lanes on 35W. And they're looking at having that process done within a year. So there will be some detours. It will affect businesses. It will affect residents to some extent. If you're driving south on County Road 10, you can still get on 35W. If you're coming north on Highway 10, or if you're coming north on 35 and need to exit onto County Road 10, I believe the preferred detour is to go up to County Road I, do a U-turn, and then exit onto County Road H. But naturally, you could exit onto County Road I and get back into the community that way as well.
So we're talking about that exit 28B, I believe it is, where you just pass into Highway 96 and you take that 10 and you come in. They're going to put that back in, though.
Correct, yes. Both bridges will be replaced, yes.
Okay. And that's the main one that's going to affect Moundsview.
It will be, yeah. It's going to affect us for at least a year. The MnDOT representative indicated that perhaps they can get that done faster. I guess it depends on a number of variables.
Money.
Well, money and weather and other issues, but they think that they can do it in about a year.
You know, when you said highway or County 10, at one time when we had two 10s, when you came up 10 and you went 10 to Moundsview and 10 to Anoka, they changed it, and I see the sign, of course, says County 10 on one and state, I think, Highway 10. But I've also seen it called County Highway 10. In fact, didn't we at one time have that sort of as our address for 2401 City Hall, County Road 10, County Highway 10, or what is it?
It's County Road 10.
Okay.
And it is a county road, and their numerical designation is 10. You know, why they maintain 10 as the numerical designation, I'm not sure what the thought process was. I can only imagine that somebody must have thought, well, that's going to be confusing to have two 10s going through,
yes,
Moundsview, coming north on 35 or south or on 65, right, and you're presented with two different 10 options. It's 12 years, 13 years after the fact, and there are still issues. And to that point, the three cities of Blaine, Spring Lake Park, and Moundsview have formed a tri-city task force to once again look at whether there should be a name on County Road 10 to help alleviate some of that confusion.
Mm-hmm.
Most people that have GPS units have experienced this. If you try to key in 2401 County Road 10 to get to Moundsview City Hall, the GPS units don't know where to put it.
Oh, I didn't know
so
that.
So there are still issues,
okay,
that need to be addressed, and assigning a name to the corridor would help alleviate some of that. A lot of the issues that persist today would be addressed.
Absolutely. 10, we still have some land that the city owns. We still have, wasn't it the service station that's at H2 across from it used to be called Donatelli's.
The Moe's.
Yeah, the Moe's, yeah, and across there. And then wasn't there some houses, too, on the west side that wanted to?
The only property that we've got on County Road 10 is the property that used to be the gas service station next,
okay,
to the sushi and,
yeah,
sandwich restaurant. But there are other parcels that can be developed and redeveloped. I think the last time we sat down and talked, there were a couple of senior housing redevelopment plans,
yes,
that were on the table. We talked to the developer for one, which would be right next to where the city parcel is. The self-service car wash is right down, mm-hmm, County Road 10, south of H2. And they're looking at possible groundbreaking in May. There was a earth mover parked on the site for a couple of weeks, and we got excited that maybe that was indicative of some impending action, but that disappeared on us. But it does look like that one is moving forward.
Now, the other one that was sort of on Highway 10, about the north side, we call it,
yeah,
that was another one that had been waiting for a long time.
Correct.
What's going on with that?
So that one, it sounds like that one is stalled. I know that there was a purchase agreement on the property that may have expired.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that was renewed. So at this point, I believe I saw a for sale sign on that property once again. So it appears to be back on the market.
How many units going back to it? How many units on the county road H2?
I believe it's in the 90s, maybe 93 or 90. I think it's in that ballpark, but it would be a three-story, and it would have a mix of housing types: independent living, assisted living, memory care.
Oh, it's going to be all the transition things.
Correct.
That a person
would
go through.
Yeah. So, and that's the whole key to that is that,
mm-hmm,
if somebody moves into an independent living unit, then they could transition to an assisted, and then, you know, it'd be the whole range of memory,
mm-hmm,
care and the senior living options.
I don't think we have that right now. The other ones are pretty much independent living, aren't
That's
they?
Correct.
It's like an apartment.
Yep.
So this would be the first one like that. Was the other one intended to be that series two?
Yep,
the
same type.
Tall?
And it seems like it seems to be the trend in senior housing is to have that the range of housing types for the seniors.
Sure. I can understand that because once they get themselves familiar with something, it's kind of nice. And for,
mm-hmm,
if there's a spouse, that spouse can stay in one of the independent living while the other spouse might be in the dementia wing or something
that's correct,
like that.
Yeah.
Continuing on with the roads, We've got some of our roads that are Ramsey County's responsibility, yes. And that has to do with, in fact, don't they, no, did we take over plowing even on
no,
those?
No, we don't.
That's, they plow it and everything.
Ramsey County does take care of the plowing for their roads.
And potholes?
Correct.
They'll do all that? And then when we do street reconstruction, what happens there?
The county roads are the county's responsibility.
Okay.
From reconstruction, renovation, maintenance, striping, all of that, snow plowing, they are responsible. So that includes Silver Lake Road, Long Lake Road, County Road I, County Road H, and you know, if there are issues with those roadways, we pick up the phone and we call the Ramsey County Department of Public Works.
Yeah. County Road I saw where their responsibility is east of 10 going over to 35. So it's not the west of 10, is
correct.
That correct?
That's
so they
right.
do that. And is that same thing that applies to County Road H? Is it like east of anything or east of Silver Lake Road or
no,
is it all a county?
H is all county.
All county.
Yeah.
Now we're going into another street reconstruction
we are.
Cycle.
Yep.
And that's going to be in which area of the city?
That'll be in the southern half of the city. It'll be in between Silver Lake Road and Long Lake Road, and then County Road H2 and County Road H. So a nice square.
Uh-huh.
It's about 4 miles of roads, and we should have a bid opening coming, I believe it's March 29th.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very exciting time of year for us. We're gearing up for the preparation of that project, and we've had some great luck and good bid prices for the previous project, so we anticipate hopefully another good bid for that one as well.
And we're ahead of schedule, aren't we?
We are ahead of schedule.
That's and this winter has been wonderful.
I'm sorry, what?
This winter?
You're
right, our fall has extended right into spring, hasn't it?
Interesting, yes.
I bet, did that prevent some of those potholes?
It may have been less of an issue this year because there was less of the freeze-thaw, which is the process that causes potholes.
Uh-huh.
We had a couple, but certainly not to the extent as in previous years.
Yeah, and now we're getting into sort of cleaning up. I know we have spring cleaning coming up too, our spring that's going to happen over here at the garage. But we also have things like, painting the water tower?
That's correct.
A new roof on the community center?
Community center, yes.
Didn't we have, we've always had roof problems over there, haven't we, pretty much?
For many years, yes, we have.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so this is going to be a brand new roof for the whole thing, or what?
I believe it covers most of the community center roof, yes. There may be, it was built in sections. I believe there's three different sections.
Okay.
And I don't know the answer to that.
I should have Nick DeBar here.
Nick would be a good one to answer that one. But yes, this will resolve all of the issues that we've been experiencing over at the community center. Mm-hmm.
And what are we doing with one of the wells? Is it well number one or something or four? So
it's a well rehabilitation project. We do this maybe once every 7 years with the wells. We just make sure that everything is running appropriately, making sure the casings are not degrading or corroding or anything. It's a difficult thing to do preventative maintenance on because it's underground. So it does require pulling everything up and inspecting and fixing whatever needs to be fixed. Again, those are issues that are planned out and scheduled in advance, and they're budgeted. And if cities don't do that, then you're faced with the potential for having to drill new wells, and that's not anything that we would want to do. So it's very important to maintain those regularly.
So this year we have 1, 2, 3 of them on the schedule. How many wells do we have?
I believe we have 6, although one, we have an additional well for backup purposes if need be.
There's been a reestablishment of boundaries, as we know, for our senators and representatives,
correct.
Et cetera. Is that going to affect much of what we have, and did it also do something to our county commissioners? Because we had Jan Parker that has a little bit of our area on the south portion, the rest was Tony Bennett. Did we get affected? Tell me, what effect do we have on?
Well, in terms of the county districts, I don't believe that there were any changes to that. There was a substantial change in terms of the Senate and House districts. The Senate district does change. It puts us in a position where we don't have a sitting senator that represents Moundsview. Senator Wolf does not live in the new Senate district for the new legislative district. So Regardless of what happens, who runs, we will have a new senator come the next election. And what I've heard with on the House side is that both Representative Tilbury and Representative Knuth lived in the House district. So there would need to be, someone would need to decide, okay, am I running, are you running, or am I going to run in a different district, am I going to move? And what I've heard is that Representative Knuth is not going to seek re-election.
That's what I heard too. Okay, so we do have, we're split again. Are we split, or is the whole community going to be in one or the other?
The city is all together in one district.
It will stay in one district.
Yes.
Well, I know we're in the 50s, so that was, as you said, our senator was Pam Wolf. So if we're in a 40 district or whatever, it must be going over to the east that we're going to be.
It is a rather large district. It extends from our corner of Ramsey County all the way into Vadnais Heights.
My goodness.
Yeah.
That's our Senate district?
Yes.
Well, that is quite a change. And as so far as you heard, nothing with our county commissioners.
Correct.
And what does it do to our precincts?
Precincts remain the same. We reestablished our precincts at the last city council meeting. So we'll still have four. And generally, you know, in four quadrants. So you got mm-hmm. northwest, northeast, southwest, southeast, mm-hmm. and that really hasn't changed.
Was it like Long Lake splitting it?
Yes.
I suppose east, west?
Correct.
And so it'll be still what we'll be familiar with, and we still will always vote over here at the community center.
Ramsey County is coordinating the elections for us this year. Mm-hmm. But yes, it's the same districts, the same process and procedures. The community center is the polling place.
That helps us in our confusion. School board, I vote on it all the time, but it seems to me we still go over to the community center on that too, don't we?
Correct.
Okay. We've got things that are happening that, and I'm going to just sort of briefly touch on this homestead credit thing that people probably are going to be very interested. They're going to start seeing their truth in taxation, et cetera, to pay their property taxes. Just how much is that affecting us in Moundsview, do you think?
That's a good question. Based on what we've seen, we're a community very similar to other first-ring communities. We don't have a lot of commercial industrial tax base, so the new exclusion program, which took the place of the market value homestead credit, it essentially took a portion of a home's value and then reshuffled that to all of the other property classifications. But a lot of that came back to the homeowner as well, and it had the effect of increasing the taxes. And it seemed as, and I saw some newspaper articles, there were some legislators who were quoted as saying, well, we didn't know it would really have that effect, or I guess that was an unintended consequence. And it turned out that, you know, for cities like Moundsview, it didn't help the property owner. In fact, it hurt the property owner because the city of Moundsview doesn't have enough commercial industrial tax base. We're a predominantly residential community.
Okay, so we will see our taxes go up, our property tax.
Well, they're talking about changing that again. There was bills introduced to revert back to the original market value homestead credit. Uh-huh. And I guess the issue with that is, all right, how do you pay for that? I don't know if they've resolved that issue.
I don't think they have. I think you're right.
I can't tell you what's going to happen, uh-huh. you know, with the property taxes next year. All I know is that it's either going to be the same or it's going to be different.
Mm-hmm. Well, all
I know there's a lot of wisdom there.
But all I know is it'll go up.
Well, we're at least with regard to Moundsview, we're hoping that's not the case. Granted, our portion of the tax pie is small. I think we're about 27 or 28% of the tax bill. Our property taxes are not going up. Our levy is not going up. Our council has been very, very clear about wanting to make sure that, especially in this time of deflating property values, the last thing we want to do is increase the levy. You know, mm-hmm. as a property owner, the worst thing to have happen is to see your property value decrease and your taxes increase. It just doesn't make sense to most people. So the council is very concerned and making a very concerted effort to keep the levy flat, if not even do what it can to make sure that decreases.
You know, that's very true about what you're saying, because we all look at our valuation of our homes. And if you look at the valuation of the home today, and if you had your old tax statement of 10, 20 years ago, you can see, and we all understand inflation and various things the government is doing that is more services that they're giving.
Sure.
But it is very hard to explain to people. So they're still going to have it where a non-homesteaded piece of property that has, it's a rental piece, that is, it's not going to make it even with a non-homesteaded, are there? You don't,
yeah. At this point, you know, it's really hard to guess what's going to happen with that.
It's going to be interesting, because even if they pass new law, it wouldn't go into effect until probably July 1st, and that wouldn't affect it until the next year. So this year, we still have that to deal with, and then probably should. But Moundsview has done a good job on that levy. It's been, what, zero for quite a few years?
Yeah, I think it was 6 years at zero. We increased the levy for the street funding.
Mm-hmm.
That was a special levy for that. And again, the street project has been going wonderfully. We have not levied as much as what was in the original plan for funding the street program.
Mm-hmm.
I think we're 33% less than what we had originally anticipated. And that could actually end sooner than what we think. So that we're really trying to maximize other dollars, other funding sources,
mm-hmm.
utilizing the Minnesota state aid dollars, utilizing the franchise fee dollars. And if there's any funding source that we can minimize, it's the dollars that come from directly from the residents.
Mm-hmm. I think we were doing on that street, was it $100 a year for 10 years that we were all going to be hit? It's only $1,000, which to do all of our streets is such a deal. And I know it was all creative and thinking and how to finance it. It was fabulous. And but if it is even ends to be 8 years of only $100.
And it's not even $100. I mean, it's that was based on a median valued home.
Uh-huh.
But that was also assuming that we were levying $400,000 a year, and I believe it's only been $300,000.
Wow.
So if it was originally planned at $100 a year.
75, 80?
Yeah.
Compliments to everybody that has tried to do something like that and still have the streets done. I think that's been fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
I know that we have a town hall meeting coming up, and it's not till April, April 16th?
Correct. Yes, April 16th.
Yes, you've got the Moundsview Matters down there.
That's right.
Yes.
As everybody else should at this point.
Uh-huh. And it's going to be again here at the City Hall.
Correct.
And they run it at 6 o'clock. And I understand you've got exhibits. They'll start earlier, I assume?
Actually, no. This year we're going to do something different.
Okay.
One of the things that feedback that we received from residents mm-hmm. has been, you know, they show up at 6 o'clock or whenever it was supposed to start and then find out, oh, well, the formal part of the meeting doesn't start until 7. So what we're doing this year that's different is that, okay, we're advertising that we're starting at 6. We're going to start at 6.
Here in the chambers.
But we'll still have the booths, we'll still have the city's, you know, the exhibits, and all that will be available after and during, you know, if somebody mm-hmm. has questions for, let's say, Public Works, or they want to find out more about the street program,
mm-hmm.
All of the cities will be represented, and, you know, that will be, you can do that concurrent with the formal presentation or after, will be available afterwards. But we felt that if we're advertising a certain time, let's start at that time and then have the informal part afterwards. And then people can, mm-hmm. If they have no questions, they can take off or, you know, they can mingle if they need be.
And I know, too, that it's supposed to be over at 8:30, so there'll be a breakdown of exhibits. Now, that is a council meeting night. No, it's not.
It is not.
It's not. So it's not so you don't have it where the council feels that they have to clear everything out to start a meeting.
Right.
Okay. I think it works well that way. Spring cleanup, I've got it down as May 5th.
Yes, that's correct.
At the public garage.
Yep.
I also saw in, I don't know what edition of the Moundsview Matters that you've got there, but I also noticed that we have a very good accounting of numbers of people that come in with refrigerators, appliances, et cetera. It seems like it's pretty much level in some of the things.
Well, it actually does track, it trends predictably. You know, there's a difference between the spring cleanup and the fall cleanup in terms of the numbers that attend or participate. But yeah, it's about the same type of material that's dropped off on an annual basis. So it helps us in communicating that information to the provider. Okay, this is what you can expect. In fact, they provide us with some of that same information. It's good for us to know what people are dropping off. And that is a service that is funded through our Ramsey County SCORE grant. These are recycling dollars that are helping to fund both the spring and fall cleanup.
And yet it still is subsidized by the person that comes in with their car or their truck and drop things off. There's a certain charge.
There are certain charges for certain items. There are free items that are subsidized. I don't know the complete okay. list, but there are items that, you know, 4 free tires or right. 1 free appliance. Mm-hmm. Last year we had an electronics drop-off that was hugely popular.
Oh, yes, it always would be. I mean, look at right now, I think the iPad 3, 4, or whatever number, 3 is out.
Yep.
And what do you do with number 1?
Yeah.
I know it. I think it is. At any rate, things move so quickly. We all know
true.
The minute you get the new one, you've got another new one next week. So I can imagine that you do get a lot of electronics that are sitting around on desks and stuff like mm-hmm. that and finally get them all taken care of. Do you have anything that you wanted to touch on?
No, other than just to reiterate that the city is looking at the County Road 10 corridor. The county intends to maintain the numeric designation of the corridor as 10. But we are looking in conjunction with the cities of Blaine and Spring Lake Park about having a name. And, you know, a number of different suggestions have been thrown out already. We have a meeting next week. We're hoping to gather the 3 cities together at some point in the next month or two and have a discussion about what would be appropriate. It's long overdue that we take some kind of action. There's a cost, you know, to re-sign the corridor, and you know every intersection. There's County 10 or Highway 10. Yeah. The county has finally got around to taking off the Highway 10 signs.
Yeah.
For 10 years, those were still out there, and that further confused people. But what we've heard from the business owners on 10 and residents in the community that they need to have a name. There needs to be something that we can tell people coming up 35 or coming down 35, okay, take the such and such exit or the something Boulevard exit. So that's something that's going on, and we hope to have something reported soon on that issue.
Well, I remembered people are throwing out the idea because we all know Coon Rapids Boulevard
right.
is still the continuation. There was no way anybody down at this end wanted to have Coon Rapids in their name. I was just thinking because when we combine names, like we've got a Silverview Park for
right.
Silver Lake Road and Moundsview. And so I thought all of a sudden it came to me, Springview Boulevard. But then Blaine probably has more. Do you know how many miles that is in Moundsview? And I know Spring Lake Park's got a portion, small,
right.
I assume. Blaine must have the majority of it.
No, actually, it's Moundsview that has the majority.
Oh.
Spring Lake Park has, you know, about that much.
Uh-huh.
And Blaine, a little bit more than Spring Lake Park, but not much. It's really just that portion, just on the other side of 65 through Northtown.
Northtown, yeah.
Yeah.
It's Coon Rapids, you're right.
Right. Yeah, it's Coon Rapids Boulevard on the other side of
Springview
Highway 47.
Sounds good.
I'll pass it along at our next meeting, Barbara.
Do that.
I will.
Do you have suggestions from the audience? Should we ask? Or anybody?
If anybody has some suggestions, feel free to let me know. Send me an email or give me a phone call. Certainly interested to hear what other people have to say about that.
Yeah, and it is part of our city. The other thing is the Moundsview Matters. Go on to the city Moundsview website, and you
yes.
can always pick up Moundsview Matters and read through it because there's a lot of information in
yeah, there.
There and it's very good. It'll tell you some more things that we were just discussing too. Thank you, Jim, for joining me, and we're now going to have Tom Kinney come, and he's our police chief for Moundsview, and he'll be on our other half of the program of Moundsview Today.
Thank you, Barbara.
Welcome back, everyone. The second half of Moundsview Today, I have a guest. And by the way, this guest, I hope that you haven't had to have him come by and see you too often. It's our police chief, Tom Kinney. And talking about the fact, just before we got on the air again, how long have you been with Moundsview's police department?
26 years.
And I mentioned how young you look. It's very hard to
Thank
understand
you. That's very
how
kind,
that
very
is.
Kind.
You started out as what? And was it immediately your first job out of your police
My first
academy?
Full-time police officer job, 1985.
And that would have been as an officer?
Just patrol. A police officer, yeah, working the
Okay, then
streets.
What are the next steps as you go through all that?
Well, the department's changed ranks and positions a little bit over the years, restructured somewhat. But, you know, there's there's an opportunity for investigations, and there'd be a sergeant. At the time when I was hired as a lieutenant, which evolved into the renaming as deputy chief. So we don't have a lieutenant any longer. We have a police officer, sergeant, deputy chief. And an investigator and other specialty assignments are solely those, just assignments. They're not promotions, so to speak. So,
okay, how many people do we have in our police force?
We have 19 sworn officers.
And that's including you?
Yes.
Okay, and out of that, how many are, as you named some, lieutenant or sergeants? And so what number do we have in all those different categories?
We have one chief. We have one deputy chief. We have three sergeants that are patrol sergeants. We have, I want to say, 10 patrol officers, and then we have one officer assigned to school resource at Edgewood School, and an officer designated for crime prevention and DARE instruction. And recently we're having a new position that's being created for the canine officer, and we can talk about that as we move
on. Yes, I'm definitely going to ask about that. So the patrol, now when you move into these various things, one of them have to do more of the night hours, or what do we do for that? And then you slowly get yourself moved up so you don't have to do night hours, or is it everybody shares in that?
Well, most often the newer officers start in the night shift, and they bid their shifts by seniority. So typically, that's kind of how it just plays out.
Okay.
So the more time you get on, then the chance you go on today's. But it's all a preference. So, you know, some guys that have been on quite a few years still like to work night shift.
What do we do with Ramsey County Sheriff then? Because they dispatch you when something happens. What's our combination with them?
Yeah, that's our closest tie with Ramsey County. They operate the Emergency Communications Center. It's located in St. Paul, and they dispatch for all the suburban Ramsey County cities, as well as the city of St. Paul. But the sheriff themselves, I mean, only upon particular specialty or need would we call them in for any assistance or service. But, you know, they patrol some of the contract cities in our borders, Arden Hills and Shoreview, for instance. And we do interact and assist each other and back each other up on calls as needed. So,
mm-hmm. Have you found out through all that time that there has been more calls, or what have we moved into and you see more of, I imagine, drugs. I imagine maybe even teen drinking. I don't know. What do you see? What have we increased in?
It's quite a span to cover, actually, 20-some years. But certainly, you know, the narcotics and drugs have evolved from in the 80s and 90s. Crack cocaine was huge. It resulted in a lot of violence, not necessarily in our city, but in surrounding cities. There was a high number of homicides and so forth. But then that tailed off, and then new things came along. And really, recently, I'd say, the digital computer age, identity theft has become a large thing. Cybercrime, for instance, these are in more recent years, of course, currently. So fraud and very kind of complex crimes have evolved utilizing technology that's available. But certainly the old-time crimes, theft, burglary, robbery, are still prevalent. Criminal sexual conduct. Domestic situations are very common.
And dangerous, I understand.
And they can be unpredictable. So, the officers train for those situations as best we can. And we're on guard quite a bit for domestic calls that we respond to.
Now, you mentioned how we're moving to the electronic age. I was going to ask you something about it because there's various bills, things that are happening on cyberbullying. Do we see much of that?
We see a little bit about that. Obviously, the schools are very involved with some strict policies and how they address and respond to cyberbullying, because they usually see it or encounter it first with the students in school. It gets reported there. And it comes to us occasionally, but, it's no different. I mean, bullying is always going on, I think, with kids, unfortunately. it's just evolved into another arena of the cyber world, and it's it can be so-called anonymous, and it's easier to do without face-to-face encounters. So it's it can be a problem, but when we get reports, we investigate them as aggressively as we can.
Now, you mentioned we do have somebody assigned to Edgewood. At one time, we also had somebody assigned to Irondale. Is it just Edgewood now, and somebody else, well, New Brighton might do Irondale, or what?
Correct. New Brighton has an officer assigned at Irondale High School.
And then the DARE program is still elementary?
Elementary, for fifth graders, yes.
Okay, and that has been really a success. That's been going on for years now, Ed.
Quite a few years, I'd say probably 10 or 11 years now. Yeah. The program is, you know, not necessarily as popular in the area as it once was, but we still teach it at Pinewood. It's a scaled back sessions, but it's still for targeting fifth graders. And, you know, we feel it's beneficial because it the results of whether it keeps kids away from drugs and alcohol can be debated. But the connection and the interaction that the police have with the students, I think, is invaluable, and that's really what we hope to gain and mm-hmm. move ahead in that kind of area.
Now, the officer at Edgewood, is that part-time or all-time when school's in session? What hours?
Yeah, full-time just during the school year. So 9 months of the year, he's there, you know, 8 hours a day, Monday through Friday. And then during summer, he comes out and works patrol on the streets.
At Edgewood, when they are there, this is just to be available, visible, so kids, if they have any issues, can go and talk to them?
The duty of the school resource officer is, it's got a list about from here to here. It can be anything. He's very in high demand. You know, he's there for an enforcement presence, but that's very little of his duties. I mean, he's there acting almost as a counselor, an advocate, you know, monitoring for safety, both in traffic issues in the morning and the afternoon upon release at the end of the day. But he's there to just assist the teachers, and he will do some instruction if asked, and he serves on certain committees there with the school staff. So he's really immersed as almost more of a school staff person than actually a police officer when it comes right down to it.
Is he in full uniform?
He wears a uniform every day, yeah.
Every day, so he's highly recognized whenever.
Correct. I mean, that's one of
the object.
Goals for that person, that position there, to be visible.
Uh-huh. We just briefly touched on it, and I want you to elaborate, because I know that we spoke before about the fact that there's going to be a canine unit, and an officer has a dog, goes home with him, et cetera. And that ties in with Edgewood, too, because Edgewood supposedly is built a doghouse.
We're extremely excited about this whole canine program, and we're very fortunate and appreciative of the council for approving this program late last year. But we have an officer that we designated to fill that role as canine officer. He just started his training program with the St. Paul Police Department March 5th.
So was that a brand new person you had to hire?
No, this is an existing
officer.
Okay. The officer that we selected is Nick Ericson. He was formerly in investigations here for the last couple of years. A fine, young, very physically fit, I might say, officer, because this position that he's immersed in is a very demanding position. It's very physical. The training program that he's in with St. Paul runs for 12 weeks. He's there with a dog, and the dog lives with him. The dog lives at his home. And we acquired the animal from with the services of the St. Paul Police Department. And along with a foundation they have, they extended an offer to pay for a fair amount of the expenses for the animal and some of the training. So almost two-thirds of the cost of the animal and the training that he's going through for 12 weeks are covered by the St. Paul Canine Foundation.
Is this what I assume, a German Shepherd?
This is a German Shepherd dog, correct.
And how old?
This dog is about 9-10 months old. He's
very
young.
Much a pup.
Yeah.
They start them young. Okay, continue. I'm sorry interrupting.
That's fine.
I can see the German Shepherd being the canine dog. They usually are, aren't they, German Shepherd?
Most often, yeah. They're most often used breed. We were fortunate. We approached staff at Edgewood Middle School to see if in their technical education class if they would like to construct a dog house. And they were very excited and were very happy to do so. They completed construction on a doghouse made of cedar. It's very well constructed, very solid.
Big?
Very,
I mean, does it have separate bedrooms? Or
well, not quite, but it's bordering on that. It's very nice. It's I think it'll make a great home for the dog and the students there. And Mr. Ken Ader, the shop teacher, did great work on it. So we're just thrilled to have it. And they presented it to us. It's at Officer Nick Erickson's home now, and providing shelter for the animals. So, but he's making progress in the training. He's just finishing, like I mentioned, week two of the St. Paul training program. And there's about 16 approximately total officers and dogs that are going through this from various agencies all over the state and neighboring Wisconsin.
And what do you see this dog doing when he gets here? Is he, we all envision a dog that might be in the airport going and sniffing bags or sniffing, looking, another one you see in movies, cowboy or the police movies, and I do like my mysteries, looking for bodies and stuff. So what's this dog's specialty going to be?
Well, the dog will be trained with the United States Police Canine Association certification, and it's will be trained for basically for apprehension, tracking, searching. Those would be the primary duties, but we will be sending him to an additional narcotics detection school for drug sniffing, so to speak. What I'm really hoping to achieve with this, and I know it will be, is the community outreach, the connection with the with everyone in the city, going to events, you know, town hall meetings, national night out, gatherings at the school, here at City Hall, and all these kinds of things. And most people just they love dogs.
I mean,
and they're fascinated by them, and the high degree of training that they receive, and then the display of their skills that they can put on are I think will be well received.
Well, as a pup, it's only 9 months old, you said, right now. In another month, we have our town hall meeting on April 16th. Is there a chance that Nick can come in, just everybody can say hi to the dog, even though it's not trained yet, but it's going to be a friendly dog, I am sure, unless it's going after you. But will the dog be present at all on April 16th?
Yes, we fully intend to have him appear at the town hall meeting with the dog. And the dog will be, you know, close to midway point in the training, but so hopefully I have enough skills to be well behaved here. So, but yeah, at least a chance just to see the dog, see Nick, and so they should be here for a period of that town hall meeting.
And the dog will be with him 24 hours, I assume. So anytime he goes or anything, the dog will be with him. When you do and have a dog and a canine, is there a police car then that's outfitted a certain way with a cage in it for the dog?
Yes, we had one of our existing squad cars. We had it converted and fit with some of the canine kind of an insert. It's a 2/3, 1/3 insert in the rear seat, so we can still hold
get
the dog.
Get a person in there.
And we can get one person if we had to transport a prisoner. And there's a heat monitoring system that controls temperatures and makes sure that the dog stays, you know, comfortable and safe. And there's an automatic release for the rear door and then these kinds of things for if the dog were in the car and the officer got into trouble when the dog wasn't out, he could able enact a button and the dog could be released. So
if I were a prisoner in the car and the dog's right here in this cage breathing on my shoulder, I'd sit there and, ooh, I think it'd be a little scary.
Yeah.
We'll
see how that goes. And but, yeah, we had that equipped, and it's the car is being utilized by Officer Ericson now and bringing the dog back and forth to training, so it's working out well so far.
When we mentioned a car, I see that the police department is getting a new squad car, and there's various equipment in that squad car. Now, is this outside of the canine squad car, or is there a new one coming and it's going to have a whole bunch of this electronic equipment? What does that mean when it says
Well, we did receive approval to purchase one more squad car for this year, if that's what you mean.
That's what I mean.
Yeah, and so that car will be outfitted. That'll be just for general patrol use, just to kind of keep our fleet in fine working order, because these cars, you know, they're running 24 hours, 7 days a week, and you know, they get some wear and tear, and they don't last forever, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So we'll cycle one of our older cars out and replace it with this incoming. It'll be a new Ford, a new model. It's a Ford Police Interceptor. It's called the Crown Victoria that you see in most of our fleet and most car cities out there are no longer being made by Ford. So this is the new model that they've released this year. It's kind of based on a Taurus-style chassis, mm-hmm. so that's what it's. It's a little bit slightly smaller, not quite as large as the Crown Victoria.
Do you guys get bigger engines? Because it's
well, they're you know they're you can... they're equipped with a police package and they're adequately
speedy.
Yeah, to accomplish the task at hand. So,
Another thing I've seen is where you see the policeman in his the driver's seat. Then there's this thing that has come out and it's got a computer and it's got everything. So the police person, woman, man, can handle everything they need to do pretty much in a roving office. It's like an almost, is that what it means by equipment too? Is that what it'll have?
Exactly. I mean, like it really is a roving office. That is their office that's out there that's mobile. Yeah, it's a laptop with all the applications that they need for report writing records and vehicle checks and warrant checks and so forth. And there's a radar unit, there's a video camera system, there's there's a long gun in there, there's preliminary portable breath test devices. I mean, there's a various amount of equipment. So it's well-stocked, cell phone and everything. And
well, I would assume that the officer that's going to be in this police car is who's ever going to get it, but it must it's going to be a rotating thing for whomever's on duty, I assume, so you'll have different people using it.
Correct.
I bet they get pretty excited about it. This is going to be a neat little toy.
Well, I hope it's, yeah, it's not a toy. This is a, yeah, this is their main, really, it's like you say, their moving office.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and, but the cars are rotated among the different guys, so they.
But it's an exciting thing to have, I'm sure, that they have, that they're going to get something like that. What is a Toward Zero Death Enforcement campaign?
That is the statewide campaign that was formerly called Safe and Sober.
Oh, okay.
And it's derived from the goal of basically hoping to achieve zero deaths on the road. Yeah. That's what it means. And but basically, it's a target of drunk drivers and seatbelt and speeders and so forth. But it really is the drunk driving campaign to stop that among all the state highways and roads.
Well, what kind of study was done to change the name to that versus the other thing that was pretty well self-explanatory? That's why I had to ask Toward Zero Death Enforcement Campaign when you're really trying to target people that might be driving under the influence.
Well, that was named by folks at the state of Minnesota. I don't have the inside knowledge on that. They went through one of those studies,
I suppose.
Yeah, and I think it was just trying to gain some attention to reducing fatalities. I mean, that was what it's about, and not just reducing necessarily speeders or various offenses, but and we really are achieving some progress on that, and I don't know if the final numbers are out, but the goal was to, in a few years' time, was to get under 400 fatalities in the statewide, and they are below that this year, so we're ahead of pace, so the guys are making great efforts.
But I think it says somewhere that 1 out of 10 people have some sort of a driving under influence ticket or on their record already. 1 out of 10. You would
assume. It's true. Actually, I think it might be even lower. 1 out of 8, I've heard of.
Is that what you heard?
Number have drunk driving offenses on their record. So, yeah, it's still a problem, and we're hoping we're gaining, education is what we're hoping to really get people aware of. And I think they are, but unfortunately, there's still enough of them out there that are still continue to drive. And
I think when you start with your DARE programs at fifth grade, all the way through, you hear mom and dad telling you, don't do this or that. I'm talking about when you get to the teenage years and you go further. Just have somebody drive that's not drinking if you're going to go to the bars. You would think that would be so implanted that there would not even be 1 out of 8 anymore that have that. But the other thing that has to be coming down the pike is going to be the cell phone usage. The distraction with that happens.
That is really an emerging issue. I agree that distracted driving, both with cell phones, texting. And all the smartphone usage out there, it's. I think it's only going to increase, and we see some accidents that are attributed to that, and we there are laws on the books, of course. It's a difficult one sometimes to enforce, I must say, but the guys are out there looking for those offenses and citing when they can. So, but it is something to be aware of, and because distracted driving, whether it's impairment by alcohol,
Sure.
Other means, or just the simple fact that you're not paying attention because you're on your phone, is can all cause accidents and injuries.
It was just a few months ago, I was driving and I saw a car pull up alongside of me, and that man was reading a book. He had it right, here's the driving, the steering wheel, there's his book, and I was paying attention because I think we were at a stop sign, and then we went. I mean, he does everything efficiently and effectively, but I felt like I wanted to lecture him. Don't read a book while you're reading, while you're driving.
Yeah,
again, this is a book.
A dangerous practice, whatever it is, if it's,
yeah,
yes, you know, if it's reading, eating, or drinking, you know, all these kinds of things. So taking your attention away from the road is potential for dangerous conditions.
In traffic, when we are doing our street reconstruction, there's been, I guess when you look at some of Groveland, Red Oak, or whatever, they'll do it where they cut in the curb and then they come back out and stuff. Have you noticed if that's been anything on calming any of the speeding? Because there have been people that have been really upset with sometimes speeding on our straight residential roads.
The theory is to slow traffic by creating these designs and some removing the straightaway on Red Oak Drive, for instance, that was done a couple years back. You know, it's hard to say if we have definitive results or answers that it's created any reduction. I can only think that the idea, it would slow traffic potentially. I'm sure some residents or people might say, well, no, I still see some speeders.
It hasn't helped
at all, if this means anything, I've got to say in the last couple of years, speeding in general, I mean, it's always been one of our number one complaints.
Right.
It's been quite a bit less than what it was in previous years. Now, whether that's because people just aren't calling about it or voicing their opinion, or if we're actually making some headway, and I think we are, in reducing speed and enforcing traffic laws out there. So the officers are aggressively enforcing the motor vehicle laws, and speeding's the number one, along with seatbelt usage.
Another thing I've seen is as you go down like Long Lake Road or one of the roads where probably speeding was an issue, you've got that generator thing with that big, I don't know, maybe 2 foot by, you know, 1 by 2 or something, with the speed that you're going at, the light, light going on. I would think, do we own that or do we rent it? And have we been putting it in all these areas that are basically for speeding, and has that helped too?
Yeah, we do have a permanent sign that's mounted on Long Lake Road on the south end of town, between Conrad H and H2. So that's always there, given the driver indication of what speed they're traveling. We do have a mobile radar trailer that we can position in different parts of the city.
Okay.
And that's will be put out actually soon. We just didn't anticipate such a quick spring, almost summer-like season we're encountering, so the roads are clear. We'll get that out as well.
Yeah, I know. I noticed that that's really a nice thing. Do we have road restrictions during spring thaw, or did we never have frozen streets to have to worry about road restrictions this year? What's going on with that?
There usually always is, of course, in the wintertime.
Do we have many people that have burglar alarm systems in their house and may have false alarms for us, or do we have many people that have that?
We do have a number of residential alarms and, of course, business commercial alarms. False alarms are out there. I wouldn't consider them a taxing on our resources necessary to respond to. But obviously, there is an ordinance. If there's three alarms within a 12-month period, there is a fine involved that we, if they're deemed false, for instance, or faulty.
Severe weather awareness. We're going to go into tornado season. Do we have anything what does that mean for us?
Well, the mid-April, the week of April 16th, is Severe Weather Awareness Week, and there will be a tornado drill. This is done on an annual basis on that Thursday, and it's done twice, one in the early afternoon, like most of the times when the sirens will sound, you know, every first Wednesday of the month at 1 o'clock here to test. But that particular day, it'll be two tornado drills, and it's just a reminder for all the citizens to be aware, that to be alert and to take shelter should they sound, and we get into this weather season. And potentially we could have weather quite sooner than we thought here with storms around the country. Has been hit with quite a few tornado situations, unfortunately. So it's just a reminder for folks to be aware and take precautions. You know, we advocate, for instance, home disaster kits. If in the worst case scenario, what should there be, for instance, a tornado, you know, all the utilities and power and so forth are knocked out, and if you had to rely on means for a day or two, you know, we advocate a disaster kit, so to speak, but it'll have a gallon of water, for instance, per day, per person. Oh. You know, first aid kit, flashlight, batteries, a weather radio is invaluable, something that's battery powered, for instance. So you can still get updates, you still find out what's happening out there or what potentially could or could happen. You know, cell phones are invaluable, but of course they're going to lose power eventually, and there are solar powered chargers you can get, but having these things kind of at hand or ready if you actually would ever need these things are important to kind of prepare to put together.
Something that's happening with Back to 50s, that there's going to be a lot of traffic. What's happening, the community center being involved?
There is a Minnesota Street Rod Association holds their Back to 50s event every year at the State Fair. And they're going to have a registration event held at the Mermaid the days prior to the actual car show. So the week of June 20th, I believe it is, through the 23rd, that Wednesday and Thursday, they will start actually rolling into the Mermaid, and they have to register and pick up their materials.
You mean these cars physically have to come here?
Well, the folks that want to register either come in with their cars, most of them do, or they have to show up to obtain their materials. And so there will be some traffic congestion disruption as a result on, I would say, probably that Wednesday, Thursday of that week, and some of Friday, because the show actually then starts Friday down at the fairgrounds. But you will see, it'll be quite a show.
I was going to say, put out lawn chair and just sit and watch the cars roll in.
But we're some of our staff are coordinating with the people involved that are running the event to coordinate traffic control and work out designs to make sure that we can keep things moving and not get too congested as best as possible during that period.
Well, I think that should about cover it for me. And we've hit a lot of topics. Do you have anything that you need to relate to everybody?
Well, I think the only thing I would just throw out there is with the warm weather and people outside, you know, be careful, watch your speed, wear your seatbelts as far as traffic safety, and
don't drink.
You know, call a friend, call anyone, a cab, get someone to pick you up, and that's just avoid a lot of problems and keep everyone safe. So
that's gotten to be quite expensive for somebody that does get picked up, I guess, because they can get incarcerated, they can be, you know, lawyers involved. So what do you think is sort of the average cost if you are caught and even convicted?
Well, I mean, I think people have thrown out figures anywhere from $10 to $15,000 potentially can cost for lawyer fees, license reinstatement, insurance, repercussions and costs. So it's something you don't want to find yourself in that situation. So please don't drink and drive.
Well, thank you very much. It's nice talking to you
again. Thank you, Barbara. I'm glad to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Yes, yes. Well, thank you. And thanks again, everybody, for watching.